Hello everybody, welcome back. This is going to be episode 3 of our Legendary Empire campaign for Total War Warhammer. I am the Strategy Professor. Let's write down the time here real quick. Excuse me. Okay, so where we left off last episode, we were able to secure Helmgart and we got Isleheart back. And be very careful of Marienburg. They have a very dangerous army sitting here. And they're also mustering to get even more units right here, so it's very dangerous. We also have these orcs that are mustering, and they might potentially take Grunberg. We're also going to get a rebellion that we can't deal with right away. Yes. So it's going to take a couple of turns to get over there to deal with that. We need to go ahead and hire some units, because we just can't really stop doing that right now. We just have to keep hiring, because there's just so many threats all around us at all times. So let's just go ahead and hire
I am innocent.
2 crossbowmen and a swordsman. Pretty much have to hire every turn until we just get a lot of this under control, and then we're probably gonna go up and we'll just see who declares war on us. We'll find out. I think it's probably gonna be Marienburg, maybe these guys, so we'll see. Something I noticed just pressing around is they already have Chaos Corruption here, and I don't understand how that happens. I mean, maybe they got offered that that deal where sometimes you can take some Chaos Corruption for cash. I'm not sure. I hope that's what it is. Hope Chaos is not already loose on turn 9. But we'll see. I know there's some variance in when Chaos can get loose, because in my Orc campaign that got to 90 turns, that wasn't published on this YouTube channel when I first started playing Warhammer, before I made the channel, Archaon got loose on turn 55 or something. But when I was watching another streamer, he didn't get loose until, like, turn 95. And it might have to do with how advanced you are. So, you know, by turn 55 in that Orc campaign, I had everything down here. And I was already starting to take a lot of this territory also. And that's when he got loose. And that's when I had a bunch of chaos spill into here. Also from these boats that I had to take care of. So, I'm not sure if it's because I just started getting really powerful, they went ahead and released him, or if it's just random every time. I'm not really sure, so I don't really know what to expect. So that'll be fun. That'll be interesting strategically. Okay, let's see. All right, so we're hiring here, hiring there. I don't think I did diplomacy yet this turn. If I did, forgive me. I'm just gonna look really quick. I don't think a lot has probably changed. We got the cash last episode, either this turn or last turn.
Got welcome, my
military
countrymen.
Or a defensive alliance with Sterling, which is great. They also have Underdog, so there's a chance they would confederate with us soon. We want to confederate very soon so we can get Carl Frank.
It is good to see fellow sons of the Empire.
The problem is, if we confederate, everyone else is going to hate us. At least all the other humans are going to hate us around, so it's going to be a big-time problem. So the people I would like to confederate with most are Wiesenland, Talib the Clans, or Sterland, just because they have good territory, particularly Wiesland, if I can get a hold of them. But, because they have really nice territory down here, further away from Chaos, not out in the middle. The Sterland, I mean, I could get them, and that would be nice, but then I would probably have to fight Wiesland and or Averland, and then that would put me on the door to these vampires as well, and it would open me up to Talib. This is just probably the most dangerous place on the map, is where Sterland is, so I can maybe make it happen, but it would be a lot more dangerous. Getting Wiesenland would be nice. It's just tucked away in the corner here, away from this battle royale, away from Chaos a little bit. Yeah, I'd have to worry about the dwarves and some of this other stuff, but I just feel like these mountains would give me a little bit more shelter. But we'll just see. I mean, I'll take what I can get.
But my time is short.
I think they paid us last turn. I mean, let's check that out. Alright. I do have trade with Bastogne.
The laws
now, if they
of
want to do
chivalry demand.
No, they don't like us that much. I am still getting a great power. What I love is the irony that I'm ranked 41 right now, and I get, you know, factions that are ranked 19 giving me a great power modifier. So, like I said, I think it's based on land, and I think your strength rank is more based on your armies than your land. I'm not quite sure how that works, but it's a little weird. It's a little hard to understand. The dwarves because that power modifier. I don't remember if I got cash on last turn or not. Let's go ahead and ask.
What can I do for you?
Yeah, I think I did. Okay, I think that's probably going to be it.
You may speak before my shield bearer.
Oh. Okay, I'm pretty sure that's going to be it. Let me just see if any of these people want peace.
Awesome.
A lot of times they will pay you for peace if they're getting beat up.
Speak up!
Where's my man?
Because they just want to get rid of an enemy. So sometimes they'll pay you, you know, 300 gold. I've seen up to like 1,000 to 1,500 gold that someone paid me for peace right before they died.
In the north, we have cold hearts and heads. Good for hunting out half-truths and lies.
I love this Russian-sounding guy. He's the man. Alright. Let's see if we give 300? No, I think I don't remember if he paid us or not. That's fine. Any other enemies? Body spears. Okay, I think that's all we're gonna get. I think we did all the buildings this turn. Remember, we're not gonna mess with this place that much, just simply because it's very, very dangerous. I mean, it could die at any point from these places if they declare war on us, so I might just have to give it up. Now, the problem is, if I run out of here, though, then I'm basically just inviting a war.
It is time,
but I might have to. I don't know. We'll see. That's for another turn, though. Oh, we do get a commandment. So, the commandment's over here. Lots of choices as the humans, and it's pretty pretty separated. Like, some of the other ones have nice hybrid choices that will give you, like, less corruption and more public order, and that will give you growth and some cash. It's pretty compartmentalized here. You really have to choose. But they have a lot of options. Some places only have up to 3 or 4 options, I think. Recruitment is nice. That will actually let me recruit faster. That's worth thinking about. And it's save 5%. So if I'm hiring,
you summon me.
Whatever, close to 1,000 a turn to get these up to 20, because I want to get these to 20 stacks, like, soon, so that I can go really flex on these guys over here. That might be a good option for that, just in case they declare war on me. I mean, the common sense, the standard would be to get the growth, so that I can level up my buildings faster. I already have pretty good growth, though. I mean, another little bit would be nice. I'm going to get 2 growth next turn, which means I'm going to build this next turn. After that, growth is not as... I mean, I do want to get to level 4 ASAP. So growth is a nice option, but I think that saving cash and being able to fill up and get to a 20 stack faster with Balthasar Gelt is probably better at this point, honestly, until I get to those 220 stacks. Now, yes, it's overkill. I mean, usually you want to do as much with as little as possible. But the problem is, I don't know who my enemies are. So I heard another streamer, you know, saying he didn't want to hire as many people as possible with this. And that's fine, and that's true. You want to do as much with as little as possible. But you don't know what the threats are. Like, when you play... Look at this. When you play something like the orcs, it's pretty clear what your threats are most of the time. And you have some security. So, if you start taking this territory down here, you have security. You know who your threats are, you can kind of see where they're coming from. It's a very limited number of people, and it's always going to be orcs or dwarves, so you kind of know what to prepare for. If you come down here, you know the units that you need, and it's fine. You can usually deal with it. There's not really an existential threat on you, which means they're not going to wipe you out, usually. At least in the orc campaigns I've played. Same thing with the dwarves. You have some security with these mountains. You can kind of identify who your threats are going to be. A lot of times people won't come down through this mountain pass. Like, sometimes they will, but a lot of times not. So your threats are really limited to this choke point, and then like this choke point over here. And you can sort of just slowly push out. Here, that's not true. I don't know what my threats are. I don't know if I'm facing Bretoni, I don't know if I'm facing dwarves, humans, which humans, I have no idea which angle they're coming from. I mean, they can almost literally come from any angle, hit any town, anytime, anywhere. And so, you have to sacrifice some of that efficiency for safety. Because you just don't know who's going to declare war on you. Like I said, down there, it's usually pretty clear who you're going to war with. Up here, it's not clear. So, you have to just lose a little bit of extra money just to be strong, because you don't know who your enemies are.
To the provinces?
I don't want to risk getting wiped out again, because I'm unprepared. Because Marienburg, like I said, they just declared war on me. They had 32 units in another campaign that I played. They just rolled right up and took this town. There's nothing I could do about that, because I was just, trying to be efficient. So,
the nation calls.
I think that's what I want. It'll save me money, and it'll let me get up to 20 faster. I will transition over to the growth once I get closer to 20 stacks with each of these. But until then, I just need to be ready. And, I might get Middenburg and Marienburg. They might both go to war with me at the exact same time. I mean, there's a lot of threat out there, guys, so I'm just going to go with that. Okay, let's go and end the turn. Vampires are very similar. You're tucked into the mountains. You kind of know what your threats are. Okay, so that's three armies in plain sight for Marienburg. And they're mustering. Oh, don't take it this turn. Don't take it this turn. Oh, God. Well? It's telling me I might be able to win this. I really don't think I can. Because he has a lord. I don't have a lord. I do have more units. I mean, if I auto-resolve it... I can at least beat up his boars, I think. I just don't know how I'm going to kill this lord, honestly. Like, he's just going to just destroy me. Well, I'm going to manually fight it. Because I'm just going to lose it automatically if I don't. And I would rather just make sure I kill off a couple of battalions here. So we'll just do this. It's going to be a losing fight. It's going to suck. He's going to sack, 3,000 or 4,000 gold worth of stuff. But... like I said, our option was we were going to lose a town either way. Either we lose this town and chase this guy and gain another town in response and wipe out another faction, or we chase this guy and lose the town that we just acquired to the secessionists and they get stronger and I don't gain anything back. I don't gain another town. The way that I chose to do it, I at least traded one town for the other. There's no scenario, I don't think, where I could have kept both towns. The way that everything was set up.
Crossbow ready, General! By Ulrich's wrath! Crossbowman!
There's a chance I could have split my army in two and maybe threatened both of them, but I just don't think I could have done that because I didn't have a very strong garrison yet in the town that I just took. So I think that the secessionists could have come up and, taken me on, 12 on 10 or something if I split up my army. I'm almost certainly not going to be able to beat them early on if they have a numbers advantage on me. It's just the human on human. We have the same units, and okay, we'll just go ahead and start this. I think okay, so I want these guys on their boars, if at all possible. I'm gonna try to shoot down their boars. So my goal here, I'm pretty sure I'm gonna lose. I want to see if I can kill their boar. I'm not going to be able to kill their lord. I just don't have the armor piercing to do it. I want to see if I can kill their boars and kill their savage orc arrow boys. If I can do that, I think that's a win. Also, if I can get these guys to run, that might be a win. Okay, so let's go ahead and do this. I definitely want these on the boar. So I want these to be my front line. Now we're at least, we can see if we can at least get an uphill, or yeah, a hill bonus on him. Lords are just so crucial in this game. Like, they weren't nearly as important to have a general in Attila. Like, it was really nice if you had a general, and they had some perks and items and stuff, but you could still defend towns very, very well without a lord. I wish they would have a hero unit that could just also defend a town by himself, so just go in and join the garrison, and he had some kind of defensive capabilities. I think that would be a nice, fair, fun way to balance it, if you had a defensive specialist. like that, because they already have lords, or heroes that do things with towns, like they protect towns. When you build extra units, they give you, you know, bonuses to those units, so... I mean, they already do that, to some extent. Okay, so we want...
We are Sigmar's heirs.
I want these guys here, on this corner.
Swordsman!
Okay, so let's just go ahead and move up here a little bit. Now they have shields. No, Savage don't have shields. So we can actually trade with them pretty well. I think we're a much better aim than they are also.
Whoa, no.
Get over here. I don't want him to have the hill advantage. I want the hill advantage. That's what I want. Okay, let's do it. Get over here. Get in here, fight these. Okay, get. Okay, let's make sure that those savages run. Okay, so they're running. Okay, so I might be able to flank around here. I want to get into these pigs. These guys are 100% going to die, so I'm not worried about that right now. Just want to flank around here. Get these guys. Shoot on these. Okay, charge them. So these guys are right here. Let's fight these. Get in here, guys. Come on. Because they're running, as expected. Okay, so we're going to flank around to the back here. Nope, don't get in there. Why do they get mixed up in there when I tell them not to do that? I don't get it. I really don't. Why they decide to go into combat like that? Whoa, why? I thought these guys are running. They have, like, no units left. I don't get it. Okay, shoot into them. Why are we not shooting? Shoot into them. Okay, get back. Get over here. Like, I really don't like this, how if there's one stupid guy that's caught up in combat there, then the rest of them won't shoot. Shoot. Okay, there we go. Fire in there. Okay, so we're charging these guys in the back. Shoot them in the back. Okay, shoot these guys now. Focus them. So let's shoot those guys. Okay, let's get over here. We're not going to be able to kill this lord. I mean, we're going to lose this, I'm pretty sure. Like I said, I didn't expect to win this. I just want to kill as many of their units as possible. So that when I do get down here and win this, or fight them again, then I will be able to win. Well, if we kite, we might be able to win this. Okay, so they're done. Of course, this guy rallies back literally two boars. Two boars as orcs and rallies back for a charge. Literally two orcs. Or two boars. If you ever watch my orc campaign, you will see just how absurd that is. Actually, no. Let's run out. I want to just run. And then I just want to shoot at this guy. I want to see if I can kite him. Just shoot him enough. Now, we don't have armor piercing, so this is problematic, but we just want to run as far as possible. We'll just shoot at him. Now, he's coming downhill at us. Okay, shoot him.
Sigmar guides us.
Sigmar calls for Heldenhammer.
Crossbowmen, detach quick, march. Ready for war.
Run. We're just trying to kite here. Oh, it's hard to run up this hill. We just don't have armor piercing. Okay, here we go, here we go. Run. Okay, so now he's running it over here at these guys. Oh my gosh, if we pull this off, this is gonna be great. So this is more akin to Hydralis. I can do this. This is like StarCraft 1 here. And StarCraft 2 probably, I don't know. I didn't get into StarCraft 2 quite as much. I did, it was a lot of fun, but then I started playing League of Legends, and then I just never went back to StarCraft 2. StarCraft 2 is great, I should go back and play that. If you guys are interested in seeing me try to play StarCraft 2, I did play it for a little bit and I got to Diamond League, kind of close to when it was released, so the strategies weren't perfected yet by everybody, so there's a chance I probably would not be as strong now, because I haven't played it in forever, but I was pretty good in StarCraft 1. And with StarCraft 2, alright, run. We don't want our casualties to get up too much either. If we take too many casualties just in our entire army, then we'll lose a lot of morale. I like how this guy's entire army has run away. It's just him. And he's at like 10% health or something, and he's not running. I guess we might as well face up on him. If we can get him a charge in the back or something. Okay, yes, yes, yes. See if we can kill him. Where's he running? No, get away from me. Okay, here we go. See if we can gun him down. Wow, we held it and we still have 5 units left. With no lord, that's pretty ridiculous. But watch out for this friendly fire, though. I mean, it's just a garrison, so I don't care that much about the friendly fire. I would really like for him to die. I mean, I guess it would be nice if he didn't die, actually, because then they won't get a new ward next turn. Hey, he's probably gonna have 1 HP, so that's good. I think that's fine. Gutstabit. That seems like an interesting name. I feel like he might be the lord anyways, or whatever it's called, faction leader. Alright, guys. Well, I have no idea how we won that, but we did. Just good micro with the, I think with the crossbowmen. They must have got a lot of kills. How many kills did they get? Yeah, 59 and 83 versus, I mean, we did pretty well. Sweet, I'll take it. I'm pretty sure they had numbers and, well, we'll see. And a lord. I mean, the lord is just so massive. You saw how long it took to kill that guy. Wow, their savage orcs actually killed more than their lord. We actually had numbers on them, but... Okay, so yeah, we had twice as many units, but still, they had a lord. I mean, that's a huge deal. A level 4 lord. That guy's so hard to deal with. As you saw at the end, I mean, he took like 500 arrows or something to take down. He looked like the giant. Well, I won't, if you haven't watched the most recent Game of Thrones, I won't say anything there. But it's a phenomenal show. If you have been under a rock and you've never seen Game of Thrones, absolutely go see it. It's, you know, I teach literature for a living. I guess a living is a very loose term. I teach literature for peanuts at the college level. If you're ever curious about how much adjuncts actually make, look that up. Look up how much adjuncts make. I'll tell you right now that if I taught high school with a PhD, I would make 50% more money than if I taught at most colleges as an adjunct. And that's if you get a good gig. My wife's father adjuncts at a community college. He's retired. He was an engineer, and he teaches just introductory chemistry and stuff like that. He gets paid, I think, $1,500 a class. So that means that if he teaches 4 classes a semester, he would earn $6,000 a semester. So $12,000 a year. You would literally make more working at McDonald's. And there's nothing wrong with working at McDonald's, by the way. I worked at McDonald's in high school. It's fine. That's fine. But the fact that you know, when I finish my PhD, it will be an additional, what, four, six, at least 11 years past high school to get that degree. And the fact that I could be potentially making more working at McDonald's is outrageous. And the fact that I could have just, you know, been a high school, just stopped at 4 years instead of 11 years and taught high school and made, you know, way more money, that's outrageous. But that's just something that doesn't get covered a lot in the mainstream media. But they really, adjuncts are some of the most oppressed group of people in terms of how much money they make relative to how competitive it is and difficult it is to get the job and how much time is invested to get the job. I mean, for my master's program, and I won't go too far on this, we'll get back to the game here in a second, but since I got started on it, just 1 minute here. My master's program only accepted 16 people out of 200 applicants. And then the PhD program that I entered accepted four literature PhDs out of about 200 applicants. So whatever the probability is there, I mean, that's 2% for PhD. So only 2% of really smart people with master's degrees get into the PhD program. And you have to go through, and it's very difficult. It's very psychologically challenging. It takes up a lot of time. It's just, it's very intellectually demanding. It's a very difficult program to finish. And, you know, I could make more money coming out and teaching McDonald's. So why do I do it? I do it because I love teaching. I love educating. I love seeing people improve their lives through critical thinking, through strategic thinking, through better understanding of literature. I love that. And so I'm willing to do it for virtually no money. I mean, my wife fortunately makes enough money to help us out, to sustain us. But it's really a sad life for a lot of academics out there. Who just can't have any money. I mean, there's stories of people like literally living in their cars so they can teach college because they love the material that much, and they just get exploited by the universities because they can. They know that people will work for absolutely no money because they love the subject so much that they teach. And by the way, most universities, I would say at least 70% of the people that you interact with that teach classes are adjuncts, like I'm describing. There's very, very few tenure track professors that actually make decent money. So most of the people that have taught all your classes, if you've taken a college class, you may not have known, but I'll guarantee you that the vast majority of them were adjuncts, or at least a lot of them, especially in 100, 200 level classes. So I don't remember how I got started on that. But anyways, that's just something to keep in mind. Just in general, you know, go out, research it, understand it, and just try to, if you're interacting with teachers and maybe they're cranky or they're having a bad day or something, just keep in mind they're probably not making any money. Like if you're working and you're a student and you work in a restaurant, you're potentially making more money than they are. So I try not to be cranky. I never use that as an excuse. I always try to be positive and uplifting in my class, but I can kind of understand why people who have been doing it for, you know, 40 years and are going to die bankrupt and alone probably from doing it might be a little cranky from time to time. So anyways, all right, let's see. So I think we need cash. I don't foresee another major fight coming. Oh, well, we don't even have, this is just a garrison army, so of course it's cash. Sorry for the tangent, guys. I don't remember how I got started on that, but I figure that's just a good place to just throw that in there, because it's something a lot of people don't know. My lord. And I don't...
News of your conquest spreads far and wide. You're developing...
Oh, that's a good item. Who got that? I guess someone else got that. Because hopefully the garrison didn't get it. Okay, what is this? Okay, so I lose 20 growth. Where is this? At Altdorf. Okay, so in my province, I lose 20 growth and negative 3 public order. So I'm basically sacrificing 80 growth. So that's like one turn of growth for 1,500 gold that I saved. So is that a good deal? Yes. So I will definitely take one extra turn to get my tier 3 or whatever if it's going to give me 1,500 gold. I'm perfectly fine with that because I only earn like 300 right now a turn. So it's effectively like 5 turns worth of gold. And it's going to get much worse than that as I go deeper in the red as I hire more units. So just to put a bow on that last conversation, I don't want your, you know, Sympathy is nice. I don't want to say I don't want your sympathy, but I'll say I'm not fishing for sympathy for me or other adjuncts or whatever. I don't remember how I got started, but I just wanted to explain the situation, and I voluntarily walked into that. I knew I wasn't going to make any money doing it. I just love the material. I love enriching myself. I love just sharing knowledge with other people and learning from other people. I think I've become a much better person, a much more enlightened person, and I think I've improved the lives of a lot of people. I know I have, because students have come up and told me, you know, years later, wow, I really got a lot out of your class, or wow, this just completely changed the way that I thought. I just get praised pretty often by students, and that's just so gratifying, because I could have gone to law school, and I know that there's nothing wrong with lawyers. It's great. They make a ton of money. I have lots of great lawyer friends. And I could have gone into financial sales. I just had lots of options. And I really enjoy what I'm doing. I just want to make that clear that I really enjoyed it, and I would make the exact same decisions that I made before. It's just, if you're thinking of doing it, if you're thinking of being an academic, just understand you are going to be poor, and there's just a lot of other bad things that go with that, unfortunately, in this country. But it's definitely worth it if you really enjoy helping people and you really just enjoy enriching your own life, your own mind. Okay, so this guy is basically done. He has one unit left. He left us alone. I can't believe we fended that off. That's crazy. Okay, so these guys have 8 units. They can get up to 14. I can get up to 20 this turn. I don't think they'll fight me. They might fight me. But I think they usually just like to chill and raid until they get to 20. So I'm going to run over here.
Step to it!
I'm going to hire... If he wants to fight me and it's crazy, I can try to run away. But I think we'll be able to handle it. So let's just go for...
Very well.
A couple more swordsmen. Now, there is an outside chance they could have horses here. I don't know how, but they could have it. Like, they could definitely have pistoliers, and spearmen aren't going to be able to touch those, probably. But I'll just go ahead and get one extra spearman just in case. They're also cheaper, so. And how many do we have? 6 here. Go for one more crossbowman. It's getting a little on the expensive side, but... well, maybe one more is a bit much. Let's do one more swordsman just to be sure here. I have a really strong front line. That's 20. Maybe I don't need the full 20.
Not likely. I'll ignore that.
Jeez. Okay, so they.
I refuse.
35.
Absolutely not.
8 units, including 3 lords, on my border here.
The nation calls.
Well, I tell you what. I'm just gonna sit like here. Now I do need to heal, but I want to sit here. And the reason that I'm doing that is if they attack this town, I think I will still be able to run if they turn on me and attack this town next turn. I will still have some support for it, so I'm still looking like I'm here. So this might make them think again about attacking me. Probably not, but it might. And yeah, this way I can at least run away, I think. Whereas if I'm in the town, there's no way I can run away. If they fight me, I'm 100%, everyone's dying. So this will at least let me be able to run away. I can even encamp, and that will give me 5 extra leadership and melee defense. Not that that's going to mean very much, but just in case. I could actually get this as well. It's an extra 15% magic. That's just not going to be that strong. I'll just encamp. Just so that if they fight me, I can at least kill a bunch of them a little bit easier. Because I need to get these 4 units here to 20 stacks so I can take this out. I don't know what this is going to be. This could be tier 3 units. I have no idea. And then I want to go over and take this quest battle out. So we held off Grunberg. This is actually fairly secure now, so I could bump this up to tier 3, but I think I'm more interested in bumping this to tier 3. Yeah, I'm definitely interested in doing that. Okay, so now the clock is ticking. I'm going to have to sell this soon. So I need to go ahead and get my crossbow units while I can.
Yes.
So maybe grab a couple more over here in a little bit. And then once that finishes, then I will be able to potentially put in another training field. Because it's just going to be a few more turns. Put in another training field. So maybe it wasn't worth it getting this weaving. I keep thinking that it was worth it to get in this weaving house, but maybe it wasn't if I just left it alone, because I haven't seen any money benefit out of that. Although, I don't know. It's tough to say. I figured it out a couple of turns ago, and that's just what I'm doing. If I left that in there, it would still take... I wouldn't get to start the weaving thing here, so it would still be 2 turns worth of gold. That's 500 gold at a bare minimum. And I think I can afford to wait one more turn before I sell this and construct the this. So I still think it's worth it. I still think it's worth it. I stand by my decision. Okay. I know none of that probably made any sense, but I think it was still the right choice to sell the original barracks to get the money building, because I think we're going to get at least 2, possibly 3 turns of money out of it. More money than we would if we were waiting. Because we have to, once this finishes, it would take another 2 turns to build this money building. So they're going to finish at the same time now. So that means we're getting at least 250 gold. And if I can wait even one more turn after that before I build this extra building, then we're getting even more gold out of it. I think. Bare minimum 500 gold. Okay, so I could upgrade this. It isn't the best upgrade in the world. I mean, it's decent. We get an extra 125, so it would take, what, 3? Is it 10, 11, 14 turns to be worth it? So that's a pretty good bargain. My question is, will I have the liquidity to afford that? I can also wait until I get the wizard here and then deploy. Now, the wizard should come up in 2 turns. I will save an extra 10%. Potentially 20%, so that would save 300 gold, which is what, 2.5 ticks, so 2 ticks out of this. So if I get this in, if I get the quest battle in 2 turns, then it's worth it to keep it. If it takes me 3 turns before I can do this quest battle, then it's not worth it. I should just go ahead and get it. But if I can get it in 2 turns, and I think I will be able to get it in 2 turns, then I'll make an extra 125, maybe 200 gold out of it. I mean, every single gold counts. I know this sounds crazy with how much I'm trying to, like, min-max the gold that you get, but it really, really can make a huge difference, because we're going to go in the red pretty soon. I'll guarantee it, getting these 220-sec armies. We're going to be losing gold probably next turn. If not next turn, then very soon after that. So it's a real concern. Also, let's see. When this finishes, I'm going to need to build... How much gold will I need here? So remember, I'm probably going to get an extra 20% discount on this, so we'll figure that up in a second, but 2,500, 7,500, 8,500, 10,500, and then one of these. So 2,500 plus... Let's just say 500, so 15,500, and we're going to be in the red. So we're not going to be making money here soon. We're going to get some money off the quest battle. We're going to get some money from beating up this rebellion, but it's going to be rough to be able to pay for all this. Now, we're going to get a 20% additional bonus, so that means that it's going to be, you know, I forgot what I said already, 10,000 something, something like that. So it'll be closer to 8,000. I don't know. So we're going to need a lot of cash to make all this happen, basically. It's not even including hiring extra units, so yeah, I think we'll hold off on that is what this means. It could save us money, it gives us a little more flexibility with our cash. We are going to get a little bit more money off of this, but anyways, let's go ahead and take a look here just real quick, see if anything's changed, anything dramatic. I think so. We'll keep looking and see if this guy wants to upgrade to military at any point. I think we need to wait till about turn 14 or 15 before we can get cash.
It is good to see fellow sons of the Empire. The...
I don't remember if they pay. I feel like they were holding out on me before. Maybe they did pay us already. I can't remember who paid us and who hasn't. But they paid us. Why are we... Okay, so they don't like that we released Skull Takers, but whatever, it's fine.
Greetings on behalf of the Empire. Now what brings you here with a sheathed blade?
Okay, just trying to get old cash here. Let's see if we get 300. So remember, I got like 3,000 gold or something from doing this stuff earlier. Maybe even more. So I only have 8,000 right now. Just think about how much of a difference that makes. Just taking two extra minutes or so just to look at some of these. That doesn't even include the trade agreements. Which don't give me a ton. It's like 60 per, but I have 4 trade partners. That's like, you know, 240 a turn. That's a lot. So I've made like 5,000, 4 to 5,000 gold off of just looking at diplomacy, which is half of the money that I have right now. What did I just get off of that? I was just pressing stuff. I think I just got a non-aggression, right? Yeah, okay, cool. Okay. So we'll just see, you know? We also just want to see how this pans out. People that don't give me the non-aggression are the people that I'm going to fight, so... So Bretonnia, the best own. You're next, buddy. Get ready. You're holding out on us? It's not going to be worth it, man. Or ma'am. Whomever is calling the shots there. Alright, they have any
don't
new enemies?
Mumble, no. Manling. Can't stand mumblers.
I'm not mumbling, bro. I'm articulating. Okay.
Manlings come. They only do.
So some of these guys, it looks like it's the same every single time, like I said, but we just got a non-aggression. Kind of out of nowhere. Now who are they fighting? It's probably because they're already at war with Carrick Norn and they just want to make sure that I'm not going to jump into that. Right, let's see if we can get some peace deals. Some of these factions are about to die once again, and they will usually pay you for peace.
Where's my man?
Usually it's at least 5 turns after you declare war on them.
I don't like looking at humans that aren't dead or dying, so speak up quick.
So I did take all of their territory, so I don't really need to be at war with them right now. They're probably going to get wiped out. They've only got 45 left, so... Let's see if we can get some cash out of them. They're at war with 2 other factions that are probably going to wipe them out pretty soon. We get 300 out of them. Nope. Okay, that's fine. Just checking in. These guys want to upgrade their trading.
Let us toast Urson to your arrival. Do not worry.
Yeah.
All right, Sire.
Nothing special. Oh, they're at war with Caricadrine. So I could go to war with Caricadrine for some cash here. They're on the other side of the world. I think that might be decent. Yeah, let's go ahead and do that. I'm cool with that.
The Emperor. A false title. Be careful what you say, mortal.
So this guy's pretty hostile. Okay. I like that. So they have some moderate money. Okay, so 1,000 gold just to go to war with some faction on the other side of the world. They're not going to run across the world and get us, I don't think. Now, dwarves are a lot less likely to give you peace. They tend to hold grudges. I mean, that's their thing, right? So keep that in mind, but I don't think I'm going to be over here anytime soon. This also gets me on slightly better footing with the vampires. Maybe I can get a trade Welcome deal with them. I highly doubt it, but either way, it's 1,000 gold in my pocket for now. Okay, which is obviously very, very helpful. Okay, so I think that's going to be it for this turn. Yeah, mustering, all of that, our techs. We have one more turn. We finish our tech. Alright, let's go ahead and go next turn. We also get vision with this defensive alliance, so we can just kind of see what all is going on. This is pretty cool. Like I said, I think having that defensive alliance is going to be a really good deterrent, too. I'm hoping that places will think twice before declaring war on us, because they would effectively be declaring war on 2 people.
A strategic overview.
Now, okay, so Skull Smashers literally got killed the turn that I said. They were probably going to get killed pretty soon. I was trying to extract a little bit of cash out of them. Okay, what do we... I can't see what they have. I hope they don't have anything ridiculous. I don't know how I can't see them when they're this close.
What?
Well, I think a 20 stack should be able to handle it, and he's healed up enough to where we can actually do things. So having this, once again, having this level 2 cow's head thing is going to be very useful for replenishment. Okay, I do want to upgrade this, but I'm so scared. Now, I don't have Vision of Marienburg for some reason now. Oh, because I stepped out of this town. It's very slightly limiting my vision. But now, the only downside to having that defensive alliance, though, is that if people declare war on Stirland, Like, if Visenland was to declare war on Sterland, I'm going to have to support them. I guess I don't have to, but it's going to destroy my diplomatic relationships with them if I don't back them up. But I'm already at war with so many people in here.
I will not obey.
I don't care if I have to jump in versus a Verland. That's fine. I just don't want Visenland to go to war with them. And I don't think that's a problem. It doesn't say they don't like my treaty with them, so I don't think that's going to be a problem. Let's see how these guys feel. Yeah, so I don't think anyone's plotting on Visenland right now, and they're starting to really take some territory over here, which is pretty cool. It's Tempelhof and them. Okay, so let's go ahead and... How are we looking on time? We're looking okay.
Ready.
Had one decent fight. Let's see if we can get another one. I'm really scared, because in my other campaign, I just had got my tier 3 building, and I swear, I'm not embellishing this at all. They had 8 massive tier 4 units on a rebellion army. So they had Demigriff Knights, they had Hellblaster Cannons, or whatever that thing's called. Huge artillery. They had great swords, 2 battalions of great swords. They had grenade launcher outriders. They had normal outriders. Like, it was just, if you drew up an absurd army that would just be massively overpowered, and this was, I think, 17 turns in the game. So I calculated up to get all of those units. If I were naturally going to get it with sort of a reasonable growth progression, I wouldn't be able to get all of that until turn 42 at the earliest. They had it on turn 17. So that was the most abusive rebellion army I've ever seen in any of the campaigns. So hopefully that's not going to happen again. I think the rebellion army usually matches the tech level that you have. So since I only have a level 2 building, I think it can only get level 2 units. So it should only be like pistoliers, crossbowmen. They might be able to get 1 tech level higher. I'm not sure. So they could potentially have things like normal outriders, although those are, yeah, normal outriders. They could get Empire Knights. They shouldn't be allowed to get great swords, demigriffs, or Hellstorm rockets. We'll see. I mean, maybe they'll just have 8 steam tanks. I don't know. We'll see. Let's go ahead and get in there and check it out. So I'm hoping that's not the case.
It is war.
Hold my breath here. Okay, it's pretty bad. That is pretty bad. So it's a ton of tier 3 units. It's got 2 outriders. Jeez, 3 cannons. So they can get 1 tier higher is what it must be. Which is pretty ridiculous if you think about it. Like, why? Why do they have higher tier units than me as a rebel army? This doesn't happen with the other factions, at least not to this extreme level. For instance, I don't see like trolls coming out in the orc campaign when I have a level 2 building. Although sometimes they do get boar boys really early. I guess it just depends. Okay, so the question is, can I beat this? And on top of it, of course, they just get upgrades. So my great swords should do a lot of work. I do have far more units than they. I mean, how many? They have 14. I have 20. See, I have outriders, they have outriders. I mean, they're just... That's the hard thing about, like, Empire on Empires. I don't really have a good edge. Like, I feel like with every other campaign, I have an edge with my composition or just what I do. Like, Vampires, for instance, they always send me the Necromancer as the general, and I have Manfred or something, and Manfred just crushes them. He's so strong, he's so much better than any other general they can throw out, that he can usually carry fights almost by himself. He's really, really good. Which, he's balanced that way. You need to be good, because you have a bunch of trash units early with zombies and skeletons and all that, so you really need strong lords. But it's just really hard to get an edge here, especially when they have higher tech units than me. Okay, so what's the game plan? So I think if we should have missile superiority. These mortars are worrisome. I'm going to need to flank around with my outriders and try to take out those mortars. It's going to be hard to do because they also have outriders. So I'm going to have to wait for their outriders to commit. They should run up ahead, I think. Wait for them to commit, just shoot them down with the crossbowmen. Once I shoot down their outriders, then I should be able to run my outriders back there and take care of these mortars. I'm gonna have to spread out like a lot to deal with those things. But I think I should be able to gun down their outriders. I should be able to gun down their handgunners. I mean, my units should deal. I definitely have missile superiority because I have 6 crossbowmen. These spears, if I can get these into the outriders, that would be awesome, but I don't think I'm going to be allowed to touch them. Infantry-wise, okay, these halberds are definitely better than anything. Well, they're not better than greatswords, but they're better than your standard swordsmen, I believe, right? They have more melee defense. They don't have quite as much attack, but they have a heck of a lot of armor piercing. So they're going to do a lot more damage. So those need to be a priority. I need to save my lord and just have him just charge from the back or something, because he doesn't have a lot of damage. Their lord's going to be really hard to deal with. We're just going to have to, I don't know, put some spears on him and just sacrifice these spears. Who cares? They can die, that's fine. The main goal is just to knock out these ranged units, get back there with my outriders, tie up their mortars, and flank around with the crossbowmen and shoot the infantry in the back. So let's go ahead and do this. Just to clarify, I just thought about with an earlier comment that I made, and this, I'll leave it alone, at least for now, off of this. But I just want to clarify that there's nothing wrong with being a high school teacher either. And I think I said there's nothing wrong with working at McDonald's. I have worked at McDonald's. I would love to be a high school teacher. The only problem with that, and I think most high school teachers would agree with me on this, is there's a ton of red tape with high school. So you cannot teach the way that you need to, that I think is an optimal way to actually shape minds and just have people learn to the max. There's just so much teaching to the test and so many standardized regulations and all of that stuff, that it's just, it's really, really hard to do education the way that I think that it should be done. And I just get so much more freedom to teach the way that I want to teach in college. So that's why I teach college level material. It's not that I don't like high schoolers. I love high schoolers. I have no problem with high schoolers. I think I'm, you know, I'm really good with teenagers, I think. I'm really good with quite a lot of people. I'm just very easygoing. I think I'm pretty good at listening to people and trying to understand other points of view. So I have no problem with high schoolers themselves or high school teachers or anything like that. It is strictly a systematic call on the United States that we just don't do high school the right way, unfortunately. And that's why I don't want to teach high school. I may end up teaching high school anyways. We'll just see. If I need the money, I'll teach high school. How often do you hear that phrase? If I need the money, I will teach high school. But I just can't do education the way that I want. Like I said, I just don't have the kind of freedom to do the kinds of activities that I think are just the most optimal ways to teach. And you'll see this if you look at some of my videos. I'm going to post some videos for educators. And even if you're not an educator, you might be interested to get my opinion on these things. Or maybe you could see some tips that I give and you could tell your friends or parents or even your own teacher, hey, I saw this on the strategy professor. He was talking about this approach. Go check it out. You'll see how I have some unorthodox ways that I like to teach and why I think they're effective. But anyways, so nothing against high schoolers or high school teachers. Perfectly fine. It's just that there's too many limitations for what I like to do in the classroom, that's all. Okay, so that's out of the way. So we're just gonna try to mortar them. Once again, we're just gonna try to neutralize these handgunners, probably with the mortars. We're just gonna flank around with this guy. I'm actually going to split up my archers, let me see. So we'll call these guys 2, and we'll call these guys 3. I'm gonna try this out. And we'll make him 4. That might throw off my hands a little bit because I'm used to Outriders being 3. But this will let me split up and go to the flanks faster when I do this. So I can just run these archers this way and I can just click over and run these archers this way. And that'll help me split up and get around the flanks faster. I think that will be more efficient. I'm just going to be getting slammed by these mortars, but this isn't a great fight. But I just feel like I have to do it because if I don't fight them this turn, I'm just going to have to fight them next turn. And they're just going to have 6 more units, and the most I could hire is 3. So you're just going to have to win fights where you're disadvantaged. That's just the nature of legendary. Or any other difficulty for that matter, most likely. Oh, shit. Sorry for the cussing there. I try to keep this clean, but that really caught me off guard that they were able to shoot that far when I'm not, so. Oh my gosh. Now, I could just run back and forth and try to... Actually, whoa. Hold on. Stop. Stop, don't. Run back. Don't get him to come at me. Okay, I think what I want to do, actually... I'm going to try this. This worked in Attila some. I don't think this is exploitative. This is just smart fighting. And, when you're disadvantaged, sometimes you just need to do this. It's kind of fun to watch. It's interesting visually. So what I'm just going to do is I'm going to bait out all of their missile fire. So I'm probably going to take some casualties this way. What I want to do is just watch where these missiles are coming in. And as soon as they fire, I just run the other way. So you're just playing kind of dodgeball here, but I have really fast units. So I might as well leverage those. Just want to bait him. I don't want to get too close.
Formation, march. Quick march.
My guys are going to get tired. I think that... Oh.
Take the ground.
Okay.
Heading out. Yes, General.
So I just want to get their mortars to fire all of their mortars on these guys. I think that'll really help. And then they're just not really that much of a threat.
Moving.
Oh, don't come up here, please. Just hang out. Just chill. I'm not a threat. Just fire your mortars at me. It's fine. I'm not a threat. Come on, just fire your mortars. Okay, I'm just going to stop and catch my breath here. They might catch on. I'm going to be very surprised if they... It's going to catch my breath. Okay, fresh. Alright. So they may have programmed them since Attila to understand this. Once again, this isn't exploitative, I don't think. I mean, they could actually hit him and deal damage. I'm just dodging them. I should be within range. Oh my gosh, did they program them to deal with this? I'm gonna just try it just for a couple more minutes here. We're almost at time. I think this battle will be the last thing. Okay, no. Here we go. Nice. Okay, so they're, I don't know what they're doing. They're just hanging out. Oh geez. Oh my gosh. We're definitely going to get hit by some of these. There's no way. Okay. Run, baby, run. I think this is kind of fun. Okay, start walking. Oh my gosh. Run. Oh my gosh. Run this way. Oh god, yeah, that hurt. Okay, so definitely lost a couple there, so it's not without its consequences, but I still think... Okay, so those are way off. But they're, like, staggering their fire? Oh my gosh, look at this. They're, like, staggering their fire. So this does have consequences. Walk over here. Alright, let's go. I think they're much better at aiming this stuff than they were in previous Total Wars. Oh my gosh. So I did lose 10 there, I'm pretty sure, with a couple of those mortar shells.
Yes, sir. Quickly.
But it's much, much better they fire at this than fire on my advancing infantry.
March as formation, march. On our way.
So I can't really see how much ammo they have left. I think they start with like 20 or something, which is kind of bad. I might speed it up here in a second. It's just, this is actually pretty hard to dodge. And I really don't want to lose my entire battalion. To run this way this time.
Seek taking position. Take the ground.
They do have limited ammo.
Detachments, move.
Here we go. Doot, doot, doot.
Alright.
That was a pretty good one. Oh, jeez. Yeah, they're pretty good at correcting. It seems like that. I think they're way better at firing in this than they were in Attila. Jeez. Yeah, they're pretty good at leading the shots. I can still respond to it, but there's just so many. But yeah, if I walked in with just with my infantry into this, like, I think I would lose at least 100 units, if not multiple hundreds of units. Can you just imagine if, like, this was all, okay, we're running. Can you imagine if this was just all infantry here and all of this is just going into the infantry? Like, that's just so much AoE damage. Okay, so this might take a second. I just don't feel comfortable speeding this up. Speed it up a little bit here. Doot, doot, doot. Okay. Because it's actually pretty hard to calculate this. Oh, gosh. Yeah, they got one there. I guess you could do this with the Reichsguard if you had to, but the Reichsguard are much slower than the Outriders, so I don't think you can bait artillery quite as much. So this is just another perk of running with Balthazar Gelt to start, is you get a really fast cavalry unit to be able to bait missile units. And once again, I don't feel too bad about this because their entire army is composed of tier 3, pretty much. And I can't even build tier 3. I literally just started making the tier 3 building. And I've been doing pretty well. I've taken every town and I haven't lost a battle yet. So it's not like I'm just really far behind. It's like, no, they just... And I kind of understand why they do this, because they don't want people farming rebellions. Like, they want to make them respectable, which is good. Because I've explained before, and I can explain that while I'm doing this. I'll just talk about some aspects of the game while we do this, just so that you guys have something to listen to while you watch this. I think it's interesting to watch. It's pretty interesting to play, honestly, to try to dodge all this. They should be at least three quarters done with their ammo by now, I think. We'll know when they're done, so let's stop firing. Oh, gosh, that looks bad. Okay, we got it. But, yeah, so you can actually farm rebel armies sometimes. So what you do is you'll just raid your own province, and then that'll give you an extra negative 33 public order, and then you'll get a rebellion. You can kill it, you'll get gold, you'll get items, and you'll get experience on your lord. So this might seem exploitative, but it's not. And the way that I explained this in the other videos is that a standard army that's going to be able to defeat a rebel army is going to be at least 2,000 gold, if not more. Most of the time, when you beat a rebel army, you're only going to earn somewhere in the neighborhood of 1,500 maximum, and most of the time it's closer to 1,000. Oh, is that a hit? It's pretty close. Oh god, this is looking bad. And so you're not making gold, you're still losing gold on the proposition. So it's not like you're earning gold by farming this. Also, you're banging up your units. So if another army shows up while you're in the middle of doing that and you're hurt, you just disadvantage yourself. Also, when it shows up, you might get another army that shows up at the exact same time, an enemy army. So that means that you're going to have to fight two armies at once now. And that's happened in other campaigns. So it's a pretty dangerous proposition. It's a calculated risk. So why would you do it then if it has its downsides? Well, it has the benefits that I just talked about. And sometimes you don't have anything to do with that army, or you need to be able to stay in a location to defend it from an incoming army. Or maybe like chaos is coming and you just need... Oh, whoa, 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 whoa. Hold, hold. No, 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 no. Why did that happen? Back up. How did this guy get up here and fire all of a sudden? Nobody's moved. god. Okay. Alright, sorry. Story time's over. I think they should be almost out of stuff now. How did they all of a sudden shoot? These people didn't move. I really don't understand. Okay, so they just screwed it all up. Alright, let's get out of here. So now, enter hard mode. Still gonna try to bait some of these shells out if I can. Wait, why did all these guys go forward? Did I press? I must have pressed something on accident that had all these people go forward. Alright, well. Should get the Outriders. They're gonna mess up our mortars here probably, but we just wanna keep firing. Oh, are they actually gonna charge us? Are you kidding me? They're lining up like they wanna charge. Whoa. Why aren't we firing? Fire on them. Why don't I have the option to fire? Oh, wait, what? Hold on. Hold on. What is going on? Why can't I fire? Like, it's not giving me the target ability to fire. What? Why can't? Oh, no, never mind. That's not mine. I thought that was my... Those were my Outriders. I was very confused. Honestly, don't know what is going on right now. Okay. Alright, so form up. I thought those were... Sorry. Okay, I ran their Outriders out. Off. Go ahead and fire on these guys. Okay, fire on these Outriders. Sorry about that. That's I have no idea what was going on. So I'm kind of hurt here. If they want to charge into me, I'm cool with that. I don't think they do, though. Okay, back up. Okay, so that's good. Fire into these gunners. Okay, run. Get these guys run. Run. Do not. Okay, let's just get in here and then we'll figure it out. Okay, so these mortars. Alright, we're running. We're running. No, not them. Hotkeys are all off. Okay, we're running up here. Fighting them. Flank around right here. Where's my number two group? Alright, so we're coming over here. Firing these guys into their mortar team. Actually, no, we're firing it into these guys. Okay. These guys, we want to fire into them. Our lord. Let's just go over here and take this group out. Okay, so I think this should be fine. Get out of there. Get out. Are there any other crossbows in here? There are. So we need to get out. So we want to make sure they go down. Okay, four. I just want to... do manual fighting and just run over there and just tie them up. Okay, so they're done. I think they're running. Yeah, just want to fire into these guys. The fights are pretty even right now. I need to watch my general, make sure he doesn't take too much damage. Okay, so let's... Okay, that's fine if he's getting into a little scuffle here. We want to get the angle on them, which means over here, over here. Okay, so we're tying them up. So these guys shooting into the back should be pretty good for us. Where are their units? I feel like... I just can't even find their units. Like, I want to shoot them in the back. Oh, they're all right here. That's where they are. Okay, so let's get over here. I mean, this is kind of dangerous firing into our own units, but there's so many of them and so few of us right here. I think this could be a good deal. Okay. I think they're all about to run. Okay, so my Outriders are getting a little banged up. I don't know how. Maybe from their Outriders. Maybe they're just guys were dealing with us. I don't know. Oh, they're actually running now. Okay, so let's just go ahead and shoot them up. Okay, so these guys can probably run them down. Yeah, that's fine. So we want to shoot, like, right there. Yeah. What did you bid? These guys gonna rally or what? Like, we won the fight. They're out of here. They've had enough. Alright, so we're gonna have to... These halberdiers? Yeah, definitely kill those. We're gonna have to run these guys down here in a second. Soldiers of the Empire! What? None of those guys... This realistic camera's annoying. Okay. Let's back up here. Because I really want these halberdiers out of here. They're kind of some of the most dangerous units, and we're not gonna run them down, so... Our guy has some pretty good health left. Okay, so that worked out very well, I think. We microed that pretty well. And the Outriders obviously got really banged up. I mean, I put them on the mortars, so I did have them just charge in. I could have just had them shoot the mortars, but I just wanted to tie up the mortars, because they couldn't fire anything. And if I'm shooting at them, they can still fire. How are we on time? We're definitely 10 minutes over on time. But I needed to do that tactic to get some of those mortars out of the way. Or I thought I did. And I don't think it was too exploitative, like I said. It was hard to dodge. It took a little bit of skill. Okay, so we can't reach them anymore. Let's just speed this up. Okay, so our guy's still running down a couple of people over here. So we'll watch him do that. Because these guys are almost certainly going to run. I don't even know if their lord died, honestly. I didn't see. Too busy microing the archers. Why did you stop? Sometimes your lords will just do this. Like, they'll just stop chasing. I don't get it. Oh, there's their lord. Gonna fire on him? No. It's fine if he's hurt. I mean, then they just don't get a new one for next fight, so I'm cool with that. Wow, we actually did way, way better than I thought we would do on that. So, that's pretty cool. Alright, that's it. We didn't even really... I mean, the mortars still had plenty of ammo. They were still firing on us. I have no idea. I guess I microed something weird. I have no idea how they suddenly got in range of my mortar. Yeah, we almost tripled them. 2.5 times again. That seems to be our magic number. Now, yes, we had more units, but they had way more tech than we did. Definitely taking the cash. I mean, we could take the captives, but the cash is just really awesome. I wonder why it's not giving us the opportunity to gain some captives off of that. I don't know. We definitely want cash, though. That was really nice. The only thing that took a lot of damage were those Outriders. I still don't understand how that happened, but... Nice, nice. This is good. Like, one of these is not that great, but if we get a second one, that'll be super good. That is fantastic. Terror can really, really affect humans. So when we fight other humans, it's going to be really good to sort of shatter their morale. Very good, very good. Alright. Okay, so we'll go ahead and call for that episode. We have a new skill we can learn. We're going to skill up here. We're probably... It looks like we can actually just start off with the skill fight. I mean... We probably need to chase this guy down first. But we might be able to chase this guy and get the skill battle. I don't know if we can get both in the same turn. Probably not, but we have to prioritize killing this guy. Because he's just going to get 6 more units next turn if we don't kill him. So we'll probably run him down, kill him next turn. We'll probably auto-resolve it. We'll just go ahead and end the episode on that. I'll just go ahead and kill him right now, just so you guys can see what's going on. And then we'll save it after that. So Honest Steel. Alright, so we just crushed them when they had an army, and now they don't have one, so I think that's grounds for an auto resolve. Yeah. So it'll probably hurt our lord. I don't know if I want our lord hurt that much, because we need to use him in this upcoming battle. Now they do have a severe ranged advantage, though, that's the thing. Is we will crush them if we... auto-resolve it, and we will crush them in a normal fight too, we just proved that, but and he only has 1 HP, we could definitely snipe him out. This guy's gonna have like 1 HP if we fight this, and then we're just gonna have to wait. I mean, I could just do the Outrider bait again. That's going to take another few turns. I'll think about it. We'll start the next episode and figure that out, because I know we're already, like, way past time. probably like 14 or 15 minutes past time. I promise we're eventually going to get down to 45 minutes. We just keep getting into interesting situations, interesting fights. You had two great manual fights this episode, so hopefully that's quite interesting for you. But we'll go ahead and end the episode here. I'll think about whether I want to auto-resolve. Once again, this just hinges on how hurt do I want my general, because I'm about to go into a quest battle right after this, or that's what I would like to do. So that's the problem. We should have tried to check with Tabakland to see if they would give us military access. I don't think they would. We're going to get a slight trespassing penalty now for coming in here. We would have to do that for the quest battle anyways. But anyways, thank you very much. It's always a pleasure broadcasting for you. Hope you enjoyed this episode. Hope you enjoyed a little bit of real talk about education, higher education, and how that works in between. Sorry if that's not your thing. But I don't think we talked about it too much. I just kind of went on a tangent. It's obviously something I'm passionate about. Hopefully you guys enjoyed at least a little bit of that for, you know, the 5 to 10 minutes I was talking about that in between doing other stuff. So, if not, like I said, I apologize. We won't be talking about education every episode. It just came up right there. And sometimes I just like to bring in some interesting stuff into the game as well while I talk. So, if you enjoy the content, if you've liked the last couple of Empire videos, or you like some of the other videos that are on this channel, please consider liking and subscribing. As I say every episode, it just helps, really helps bring visibility to the channel, bring some fresh faces in here, and just bring the same kind of entertainment that you enjoy to other people as well on YouTube. And it's just one simple click. It doesn't cost any money, as you guys know. Just one simple click that just really helps build the visibility of the channel so that other people can also enjoy the same kind of content that I hope you're enjoying in this channel as well. So thank you very much. It's always a pleasure, and I hope to see you next time. Have a wonderful evening.